So let's start our discussion from where we left yesterday, and we started looking at how to design a lexical analyzer, what it is supposed to do, and what are the kind of issues we may face while designing it. And the one issue we looked at was three format versus six format, and we started looking at whether keywords were reserved or not. Okay. And we were looking at some examples of PL1 where we found that keywords were not reserved and what kind of problems it can give rise to. There are some examples where you find that reading them, parsing them, understanding them will require some skill. It's not straightforward. Okay. Another issue in a similar language maybe, take something like keyword like declare. Okay. Now declare is a keyword which says that I want to declare certain variables of certain type. Okay. So I want to give a list of arguments here. And at the end, I may say colon integer, and I may say that all these variables are of type integer. But it is also possible that actually this is a function, okay, or this is a procedure name, where I'm passing all these as parameters. Okay. Now, when do I figure out that I'm dealing with a keyword which is declared, or I'm dealing with an array reference, or I'm dealing with a procedure or function? Okay. Syntax appears to be same. So that means I'll have to have some arbitrary look ahead, because this list of arguments can be arbitrarily long. Okay? And I'll have to have some arbitrary look ahead where I'll say that when I encounter a character after the right colon, then only I will know whether I'm dealing with a declaration, I'm dealing with an array, I'm dealing with a procedure, and so on. Okay? Now, this problem becomes really difficult, because if I'm saying that, remember that when we said that I'm going to design a lexical analyzer and my input is going to be the buffer. And my input pointer is just moving left and right over the buffer to make sure that I'm reading something and I'm ungetting something, which means putting it back into the input stream. Okay. Now if this list is arbitrarily long, it is possible that the whole list may not fit into the buffer. That means I'm loading buffers, I keep moving, and then after flushing many buffers, I encounter this character, and at that point of time I decide that I have already flushed these buffers. That means because of arbitrary look ahead, either I need very large buffers, and even those large buffers may not be sufficient, so I may have to reload the buffers. Right? So I gave you some examples of Fortran and PL1. Now, people may argue that look, these are some vintage languages, nobody uses them, and therefore this problem does not persist today. So question is, have we resolved this issue now? You know of some examples of languages which are very prevalent today, which are used commonly, and still have these kind of issues where I cannot just find out without the context what kind of lexeme I am dealing with. Anyone has an example in mind? So here is an example from C++. Okay, we have these syntax for template. Okay, and then you have input and output symbols, right? And now when I have nested templates, what is it? Is it coming because of this nesting or because of the output? I don't know by looking at it, right? So it's not that we have resolved all these problems. Okay? Only thing we have to remember is that all these problems I have described so far, they cannot be resolved just by looking at the lexical analyzer. I need to know something about the tokens which occur in this context. That means I have to shift this problem or part of this problem to the syntax analyzer before I start finding out that what kind of symbols I am dealing with. So if the symbol occurs in this context, then I know. See, when I am just tokenizing it, okay, I will not know, because I have already tokenized, I have no other information, and I am trying to tokenize this, and I have no clue of what these tokens are. Okay? So if it is in this context, then I say that it is coming because of the nesting, and actually these are two right arrows. And if it is coming because of this syntax, then I say this is an output. Okay? But this context I will know only when I handle the subsequent phases. So most of these problems cannot be handled by a lexical analyzer alone, and I need to do something more. That means I need to pass on this information to syntax analyzer and then resolve what these tokens could be. So is this issue clear to everyone? Okay. So question that comes is now, so let's now get into implementation of what you want to analyze here, or how we want to tokenize, and how do we describe tokens? Okay. So here is some set of lexemes, okay, which are basically numbers. So I have a floating point number here. Okay. I have another number and yet another number. Okay. And we want to now break this text. So this is the first problem, as I said, we are going to face. Okay, we want to break this into a sequence of tokens. Okay. So here is yet another example. So I'll use a lot of examples to describe what we are trying to develop here. Okay. And here is yet another example. Okay. Now, what is the difference between the two? So if I look at this, what does it say? So this is saying if x is equal to 0, then a is assigned x, and then what happens here? Because of the priority of the operators or precedence of the operator, okay, I will say that I want to first do a left shift on x and then I assign it to x, and here we are just saying this is Boolean. But here, if you see, there is an additional if which has come here. Now, how do I break this? Is it if and then followed by a variable, or this IFF is a variable? Any answers to this? Any question? Any feedback? Anything?
As far as lexical analyzer is considered, we should consider IFF as an identifier, but code should lead to an error in subsequent phases of
compilation. Okay. And why do you say that we should consider IFF as an identifier? What is the reason for doing that, or what is the rationale for doing that?
So we will consider the end of the token at the white space.
So that again depends on the language specifically, right? Because I mean, if you are dealing with languages, okay, different languages like Fortran, okay, then you would have tokenized it differently, right? I gave you an example yesterday, right? Then I would not have considered this as saying that this is an identifier, but the compiler would have required that this is how I should tokenize. So language is going to play a big role, and somewhere the implementation issues will come in. So what you have to remember here are two parts. Okay. One part is the specification, and another part is some part is given by the specifications, but specifications sometimes may not be complete. They may leave something to implementation, and that point of time, implementation will start coming into issue. So we'll talk about both of these.
Can we send both the interpretation from the can the lexical analysis and both the, since it has to make a decision that it don't make that because it don't have the whole information about it. Let don't make the decision, send both information to subsequent phases and they will decide.
So, just like so the comment which is being made is that let lexical analyzer not decide. It can send multiple interpretations to subsequent phases, and then subsequent phases, when they have more information, they can take a decision. True. I mean, that is possible. That is what we were discussing in the previous points. Okay. But suppose lexical analyzer can make a decision. Okay. Then there are some issues which are going to be implementation issues. Okay? So let me give you another example of implementation issues. Okay? When I give specifications of tokens like identifiers, okay, I say it's a string of characters followed by a character or a number or a digit. Right? Now if I say x10 is an identifier and x100 is an identifier, okay? Now, should I start saying that since I already know x10 is an identifier, okay, maybe it's already in the symbol table. This also, remember that this also matches specification, x could be an identifier. So can I tokenize it here and say that this is actually an identifier followed by a number? Okay. We should not, right? But that is a matter of implementation, because this matches specifications, but somebody can say, well, x is also an identifier, and I can start just saying that X, break X, and then say 100, and then subsequent phases will say, oh, that's an error. That's not possible.
I'm the largest identifier.
So that's a matter of implementation. Right? So we'll go into that when you say that largest, okay? That is, we are using a principle of what is known as maximal bunch. Okay? We always want to, but that will depend upon implementation, whether we are able to really do that or not. Languages will not clearly specify it. Okay? So let's keep on discussing these issues. So how do we break input into tokens efficiently? One is that the tokens may have similar prefixes, like here, right? Or I'm giving an example here, where the prefix is similar. We have to be aware of this, and we actually want to look at each character only once, right? So this idea of saying that I keep on pushing my characters back into the input stream and keep on moving my pointer over the input, okay, that is going to be an overhead. So once I have taken a character into the buffer, I want to handle it very efficiently. Okay? So continuing on our description, okay? Now tokens can be described by regular languages. Okay? And you're familiar with what regular languages are. Okay? And obviously they have certain properties. They have very nice mathematical theory which has been developed around them. And we can develop also tools for really handling the regular languages. And this, since we have discussed this in the large detail in theory of computation, I don't want to get into the properties of regular expressions. I just assume that you remember it, and if you do not, you will go back to your notes or the books and just revise over it. Okay? And the notation we are going to use is very similar, that sigma is a set of characters I have in my language, and then a regular expression R denotes actually a language LR. Okay? And then we say that I can now define rules using the standard operators I have in my regular definitions. So epsilon is a regular expression which we say that is the null language, and A is a symbol in A. If A is a symbol in sigma, then we say that this expression, bracket A, denotes a regular language. Okay? And then I can use operators. So if we say that R and S are two regular expressions, then the languages they denote are LR and LS, and or they specify R. And if I take concatenation operator, then I'm saying that R followed by S is actually a union of languages LR, LR and LS. And if I take, so this is OR operator, this is concatenation. And then I can talk about closure operation. Okay? And as I said, this is just for the sake of revision. Okay? So these are the operators I'm going to use for specifying my regular definitions or regular languages. Okay? And here are certain examples. Okay? So what we want to do is, we want to use something known as regular definition. And this is something we need to understand, because now we are getting into an issue of implementation, and we are moving away from, or we are moving ahead of specification. So what we want to say is that if I have a regular expression, R, some regular expression, I want to give a distinct name, because I don't want to keep on using these regular expressions in expansion. I want to give a distinct name, and this is, I can see almost like a similarity when you write something like a function. You say that, look, there is some work which needs to be repeated again and again, and therefore I don't want to do that work of repetition. I just give a name, and then every time I just pass an argument. Here there is no concept of an argument. That is the closest similarity I can see here, that to every regular expression I am going to give a name rather than using RI over and over again. Okay? And then we will say that if I have a regular expression, let's say R1, I give a name D1 to this, okay? And then I have a sequence of these regular expressions, and let me give these names, okay? And the only property I need to worry about here is that whatever is my first definition in this sequence, okay, that is a regular expression over sigma. Okay, so this is a regular expression which is over sigma, but when I look at R2, because I already have a D1 here, which, so I have given a name to this regular expression, I can say that this is actually a regular expression over sigma union D1. Okay? And if I look at R3, because these names are available to me, I don't want to repeat. So this is like D1 and D2 can be replaced by these regular expressions. I don't want to repeat it here. So all I am saying here is that this is a regular expression over sigma d1 and d2 and so on. Okay? So I can have this sequence of regular definitions. So what we say here is that regular definition is a sequence of this form, okay, where the only property I follow is that if I look at any regular expression Ri, this is a regular expression over sigma and all the definitions which have already occurred. So I don't use forward definitions, I don't use any concept of recursion here. All we are saying is that I just don't want to repeat this regular expression again, and I use a very concise notation. That's the only thing I have introduced. Right? Okay. So here are a few examples of how I use regular definitions for describing some regular expressions. So here is my fax number. Okay. Now, if I want to describe this, so I gave you an example that suppose I have a lot of these numbers and I want to find out all the code information here. Okay. I can describe this by saying that what is my sigma? It consists of digits and I have special characters left and right bracket and a dash. Okay. And then I can say that it actually consists of a country code, which is a string of digits. And then I have area code, which again is a string of digits, but which I put in brackets. And then I have exchange information, which is a list of digits. And then I have the phone number, which is 7586. That also is a list of digits. Okay? And then I can describe, I can say that every number must have this form. That's really the valid form. In fact, I mean, one use you can clearly see here is that when you actually make a call somewhere, you just send a string of numbers. Okay? And when they do billing, they are very able to, they are able to really find out to which number you made the call. So they can find out whether this is an ISP call, STD code. They can just process that. Okay? You can write a program and you can process all that information. Okay? But then there is an implementation issue that comes. Okay? What is a valid country code, for example? Okay, I'm talking about now all this information saying this is just a regular expression. But I may say, for sake of implementation, that no country code can be more than of 3 digits. I may want to put certain restrictions. Okay? Or no area code can be more than of, say, 4 digits and so on. So then the implementation issue comes in, and the tools we have, they'll provide you certain more ways of specifying and say that this can be a digit, a string of digits of at most, say, length 2, okay? Or this could be a length of digits of at most 3 and so on. Okay? So I can also put these kind of additional specifications. This is not part of regular expressions, but this is part of the tool you are going to use for implementation. Okay? So do you remember that in Lex-like tool, you could put these kind of restrictions saying that what is the maximum length of a string I can have? So remember somewhere we said that an identifier can be of maximum length 32. Right? Now for implementation, I need to remember that. Okay? And then this can be part of your specification. It will say that if your country code is, say, more than 2 digits long, okay, then that's invalid. Okay? So this is where slowly we start getting into the implementation issues, saying that we have some specifications, but for sake of implementation, we need to have more precise information about what can be a valid token or not. Okay? So I'm not going to have an arbitrary long string of characters and say this is an identifier. I'm going to put a restriction that whether it is 8, 16, or 32, and so on. This issue clear to everyone? Okay. So more examples, okay, before I get into programming languages. So here is my email ID, and if I want to describe this as using regular definitions, okay, what is my character set here? It's a letter, and then I have dot and symbol at. So this becomes my character set. And then I can say what are my letters. So I can, rather than using these alphabets over and over again, I can give a name to this and I call this as letter. And then I say that name is nothing but a string of letters and address is nothing but a name followed by this symbol followed by name and so on. Okay? I mean, you can have different descriptions. So you may say that this is the domain information and so on. Okay? And you can write a different kind of description for this. But this is one value. This is one description, one of the descriptions. It is not the only description. So let's get into more examples, and now I want to get into something which is closer to what you're going to implement as part of your projects and as part of programming languages. So I want to give specification for an identifier. Okay? So identifier is something we have been discussing right from the beginning. So identifier is nothing but it consists of letter and digits, and it always starts with a letter followed by at least one letter or digit. It will consist of at least one letter and will be followed by zero or more letters and digits. So this is the kind of specification I can have for identifier. So what you see here are combination of specifications and combination of the definition names here. So I have just taken this and I have given a name to this letter. Now this is something which we have used. You could have used any variable here, okay, which is this thing. We don't care about it. Letter is something which symbolically immediately tells me that when I start reading my specification, what is it that I'm trying to read. But there is nothing sacrosanct about it. I could have used anything here. Okay? So here is a letter specification which says letter is nothing but it consists of either A or B. So all lowercase and all uppercase letters have been captured in this. Okay? And similarly, all the digits from 0 to 9 and identifier can be specified by this. Okay? Similarly, if I want to write, say, unsigned numbers in Pascal, then I am saying that I have these. So these are floating point numbers or real numbers. I have these digits, and so digit is 0 to 9, and then I define another name which I say is consists of digits, but it has at least one digit. So they cannot be 0, so I use now a new operator which is plus and say that it consists of at least one digit, it cannot be empty, and then fraction part, okay, is going to consist of dot followed by at least one digit, or fraction may be completely missing in my number. And then I may have exponent, yeah? And exponent I will have this letter E followed by an optional sign. So I am here saying that the sign of the exponent could either be plus or minus, or it could be missing. And if it is missing, then there is going to be a default interpretation which will say that it is positive. And then if I am using this notation, then I must have at least one digit. So I cannot have numbers like this. Okay? This is invalid. So if I have E, then I must have at least one digit. It will say that what is the exponent value, or the whole exponent may be missing. So that's optional. I'm putting an epsilon there. And then if I want to say number, then number is consisting of nothing but digit followed by a fraction followed by an exponent. Okay. So this way, I can keep on developing the complete set of regular definitions for whatever language I have. Time to pause and discuss. Is this clear to everyone what we are trying to do here? I mean, you have already done this when you were using legs, okay? And you already know that how to use regular expressions. So I'm assuming that this is not something which is very new. It's just a matter of a notation here. Shall we move ahead? Okay. So now, once we have regular expressions in specifications, we also need to worry about implementation, because remember that I can write specifications, but somewhere there are going to be issues of implementation. So implementation wise, what is the problem? So regular expressions, they describe almost all the languages we deal with. Okay? Regular expressions are sufficient to describe the tokens, and obviously, as I said, in many cases they may not be able to find out what is the exact token, and they may pass on information to subsequent phases. Okay? But remember that these are only specifications, and I still need to worry about the implementation part. Okay? So question now is that what is it that I am trying to implement? What is my input to lexical analyzer? To lexical analyzer, I am saying that I have a string S and I have a regular expression R. And question I want to ask is whether this particular string belongs to the language specified by R. This is the question I am trying to answer while doing lexical analysis of the programs or in the compiler. Okay? But if I say just solution, I mean, although this is the basis, but if I just give an answer which says yes or no, okay, that's not sufficient for our purposes, because we are trying to generate information for subsequent phases. So if I just say that yes, it belongs to this language, okay, I mean, big deal. So what? What do I do with it? Okay? So what I'll say is that I also want to tokenize it. I want to generate information, and tokenization is really the implementation part. Okay? So goal is not just to give this answer. Okay? This answer will tell me whether it is an erroneous token or not. But more important answer for me is that I want to partition this input into tokens. Okay? And that is where all this information about maximal munch and the ordering of tokens, etc., will come into picture. Okay? And the tools we use. Okay? So let's look at how do we write, or what is, how do I parse, how do we tokenize? Okay, parsing will come later. Okay. So we want to write regular expressions for lexemes of each token, okay, like we have written for numbers and identifiers. Okay. And then what we do is, once I have written all these definitions, I now construct R, which consists of all these regular definitions. So for each, like for number, identifier, and so on, okay, I will have these different regular expressions, and using this operator, I'm going to construct a large regular expression. And now the question I want to ask is, my input token is a sequence of characters, x1 to xn. Okay? And now I want to say that for some value of I, which is bounded by 1 and n, I want to check whether x1 to xi belongs to some LR. Okay? And obviously, it will belong to one of these LRs. Okay? So when I say it belongs to LR, what that means is that it will belong to one of these, and I need to find out. Okay? So I start, because this is now saying that I'll scan my input from left to right, character by character. So this is my input, and I'm looking at now a prefix of this, and say that, can it be a token? Can it be a valid word in the language I have? Okay? That is the question I want to answer. And therefore, I say that if x1 to xi belongs to LR, what that means is that actually it belongs to one of the LRJs, right? And for some value of j, okay, and we want to find out that what is that smallest j. And the smallest j immediately says that when I say smallest j, it's not in size, but is in the order. Okay? So these are the ones which are coming in certain order, and therefore, when it comes to implementation, okay, it becomes very important that in which order do I specify my regular expressions. Okay? So for example, okay, coming back to what you already saw in lex, okay, suppose I give an order where I say that keywords will come later than identifier. Then every keyword will also be matched by an identifier. But if I say identifier, keywords will come first, what will you do? You'll first say that I am going to do this match, and only if it does not match, if it is a longer match, then only it will go to identifier. Okay? So order becomes, so different tools are going to give you a different way of ordering. And suppose you don't use a tool at all. Suppose you want to write your C program. Okay? Then what is the order? Okay? You'll have to then worry about what kind of order you're going to use. Okay? And then it becomes part of your implementation. So remember that this is not something you can just ignore. You have to worry about whether you are using tool or whether you are using a C program, assembly language program, whatever implementation you want to do. So I can have these specifications, but implementation is going to be as much important. And you will have to worry about that, when to stop and when to say that I have reached the word boundary. Okay? And that's something, if you are not careful, you can just generate sequence of tokens which are invalid tokens. And again, we take more examples of that. Okay? They'll shortly be coming. So then, once we have identified that it belongs to one of these regular expressions, what do? I remove it from input, and then I start tokenizing rest of the input. So basically, this is saying that I start from, in this string, I find a prefix which becomes a token, then I remove that and start looking at the beginning of the next token. And then we find the next token and so on, till I have exhausted all the input. So I'll just keep going back and we'll be tokenizing my input again and again. Okay? So every time I go through this iteration, I'm generating one token. Okay? So algorithm normally gives priority to tokens which are listed earlier. Okay? So treat if is a keyword and not an identifier. So if I encounter an if first, okay, then I'm going to say that this is a keyword. But how much input do I use? And that is where we say that I want to do a longest match. Okay? So normally, all lexical analyzers will say that pick up the longest possible string in the string in the input. So here you will say that when I have something like this, okay, I'll not just stop here, but I'll say that go all the way till you can consume it. And only when you're not able to consume it from this rule, so suppose after this I have a less than sign, then you know that I'll not be able to consume this particular symbol in this token, because it will not match any of the specifications I have, and then I'll say this is my word boundary and this will not be my word boundary. Right? So that becomes an implementation. Okay? So regular expressions, they are going to provide very concise notation. Okay? And good algorithm requires a single pass. I mean, I don't want to have multiple pass over my input. Okay? That is an efficiency issue. So how do we break up text? Okay, here are some examples. So if I say else x is assigned 0, okay, there are two ways I may be able to break. Okay, I may be able to say either this, okay, or this, but maximal merge principle will say that this is how I should break because this matches specification of an identifier. Okay, so normally the longest match is the one which is going to win and ties are resolved with by prioritizing goals. Okay, so if you have common prefixes, and you need to prioritize them. And lexical definition basically now consists of regular definitions, priority rules, and maximal merge principles. So here you can see that here I have clubbed everything. I have clubbed not just specification, but I have also clubbed the implementation which says that order in which tokens will occur and the longest match. Okay. So together this becomes specification for your lexical analyzer, not just the specifications of the tokens. So all three have to come into the picture.
Maximum merge principle will be used for some languages. Formally, the specification doesn't distinguish between the use blanks for specification.
Yes.
For C-like language, it will not be used.
For C-like language, okay. So, what is the counter example? Why it will not be used for C-like language?
So, like, we don't have.
I immediately cannot think of an example. If you have something in mind, tell me that.
So, in C, we separate. By some blanks, we have some boundary word boundaries.
Mm-hmm.
So we can look into those and then tokenize it.
Yeah. So
instead of longest match principle.
So only thing you have to worry about in C is something like this, right? Okay. So what is the, if I don't use maximal merge, then will I break it into this or into this?
So this cannot.
You can take any keyword. For example, if I take this.
But in C, it will be considered that this equal to is word boundary, so the token will be IFF.
Yeah, but see, I will not reach equal to, I'll start reading from here. So I'll read I, then I'll read F, and then I have to take a decision whether I want to read one more F or I stop there.
Earlier we discussed that we read up till a boundary that says read.
So that's part of your implementation, right? Now, if you say that, look, keep looking, keep consuming something till you hit a word boundary, okay, that is saying that go for longest match.
Yes.
No? Why do you say that? You keep going for the longest match.
Word boundary is a different thing. In this case, what we are saying that my word program is just large string.
My input is a string, good. Okay.
And now I am breaking it into tokens.
See, where do you specify word boundaries? Is it specifying word boundary is part of your implementation. So when I write my regular definitions, okay, is there somewhere specification where I was saying that here is a word boundary? You?
I don't understand.
Okay, so question is discussion about how do I specify my word boundaries? Okay, so let me go back. Just a minute. So here is set of specifications I have for letter, digit, identifier, and numbers. Okay. And I can add one more specification. And let me say that, which I'll say is additional add operator, which I'll specify as plus or minus. Okay. This can be my complete specification for expressions, which consists of identifiers and numbers and operator. Right. Now, where do I specify what is my word boundary? So I can also throw in one more specification and I can say a keyword but keyword is not really part of specification, that will be part of an identifier and then I'll have a list of keywords. where do I specify that I have certain word boundaries in this specification?
So we cannot specify the word boundaries.
So when I say I cannot specify word boundaries, how do I know what my word boundaries are?
It is implicit in the definition of all these things.
No, wait a minute. How is it implicit? So what do you mean by implicit?
Like when we are reading from I,
mm-hmm.
if we encounter F, then we look one ahead, we find what's next.
Mm-hmm.
If it is like equal to sign or something white space, then we will say that it's F. And if I find another F...
Wait. I understand that part. I'm saying where is it specified?
It cannot be...
So if it cannot be specified, but I have to implement a lexical analyzer, okay, where do I capture this? Is it part of your specification or part of your implementation? If it is part of your implementation, then you have to use certain principles saying like longest match. It's not specified anywhere. Right? So somewhere, now if I go forward once again and take you to last point I summarized, okay. Lexical definitions consists of regular definitions and priority rules and maximal bunches. Okay? Now, maximal bunch is a principle I am using here, saying that I want to go for longest match, and that is when I can say that keep on reading. Suppose I did not have maximal bunch and I replace that by first match. Then what will happen?
It will be if.
So that means your lexical analyzer has to consist of implementation rules as well as the definitions.
Sir, for applying maximum bunch principle, we need to have a...
Wait. So let's not worry about how I'm going to implement maximal bunch. That's really not the point here. That point we'll come to later. All I'm saying at this point of time is that when you talk of a lexical analyzer, it is not just sufficient to say that here is a set of regular definitions, just go ahead and implement it. You need to specify something more, okay? And that something more is that we'll say that we'll always go for longest match, or we'll say that the first specification I find in that order, if I find something which matches earlier, then I use that rather than trying to exhaust everything in that sequence. That is part of your implementation. Okay? So you cannot ignore this part for implementation of a lexical analyzer. That's the only point at this point of time. So not everything is captured just by the definitions. This only says what are the valid tokens. Okay? But how do I tokenize? That comes from this part. That is where all these word boundaries are going to get captured. This point clear to everyone? The discussion? So in fact, I mean, this is a very important point, because when you start implementing lexical analyzer and when you start writing lex specifications, if you are not careful about the order, suddenly you will find that the token sequence. So internally, Lex assumes certain things. Lex assumes that it will tokenize, it will match specifications in the order they occur, and it will go for maximal bunch. Okay? Now, if you are not careful about that, then you can find that the sequence of tokens, if you don't write your specifications correctly in that order, then suddenly you will find that sequence of tokens is different. So I can take two set of specifications, change the order, and my sequence of tokens outcome is going to be different. Okay? And that is what we have to be careful about. So it's an implementation issue. I may have the same set of specifications, and if I use a different order of writing that, then suddenly you will find that my tokenization happens differently. Okay? So do we agree on this? Shall we move ahead? Okay. So what we want to do now is, okay, we want to slightly move away from regular definition. Okay? And I want to introduce a new notation called transition diagram. Because remember that one thing we were talking about was, we said not only we want to use tools for implementation, but somewhere I may want to do a manual implementation. I want to write not specifications in regular definitions, but I may want to directly write C code for sake of efficiency. Okay? But when I'm writing C code, I don't want to be writing C code in a haphazard manner. I want to have some systematic way of specifying or some systematic notation of saying that what are the kind of tokens I have. Okay? So for that I introduce transition diagrams. Okay? Again, I not worry about properties and so on. I'll go for implementation, and you'll find that when I start talking about transition diagram, there's something you have already seen. Okay? So what you want to do is the regular expressions are some kind of declarative specifications. Okay? And transition diagram is really the implementation part. So again, I'll keep talking about implementation here because ultimately that is what you have to do. So what we do is transition diagram really consists of a set of alphabets which belong to sigma, and then it consists of set of states, and then I can have transition from one state to another on certain input. Okay? And then we have a set of final state and a start state. Okay? And what we'll do here is that when I say there is a transition from state 1 to a state S2, a state S1 to state S2 on A, I can say that if I am in state S1 and input is A, then go to state S2 and I had some pictorial notation, where is it? There were some pictures which are supposed to be there, maybe that is on subsequent file. Okay? So when I reach end of input, then we say that we are in the final state, and then accept. Okay? You will find that what I am talking about is something finite state machine, and otherwise reject. Okay? So okay, so that's on this one. Okay? So state I will use notation as a circle, and final state is going to be two concurrent circles, transition is going to be narrow. Okay? And then I will say that transition from state I to state J is going to be captured like this. Okay? And then transition diagrams become very easy way of specifying my tokens and then going for directly taking me to the implementation. Okay? So how do we recognize tokens? What we'll try to do is we'll try to now develop transition diagrams for these kind of specifications. So here is, I have enriched my language. So I'm saying that I have these relational operations, I have identifiers, I have numbers, I have delimiters which are blank caps or a new line, and then I say I have white spaces which are one or more occurrences of a delimiter. Okay? And I want to now develop transition diagram. So what we want to do is we want to construct now a lexical analyzer which will give me this token attribute pair. Okay? And here I want to go for manual implementation. Okay? So I don't want to use regular definitions. I want to convert these regular definitions into some kind of transition diagrams. Okay? So let's start with something, okay, and start sort of developing diagrams for this. Okay? And this diagram will then start capturing all the implementation details. Okay? So if I want to deal with identifiers, okay, I am in some state, and so if I try to develop now this transition diagram for identifier, I am in some state. What is the first character I can see? First character I can see is only a letter, right? So if I see in this state, I can only see a letter, anything else is invalid. That will take me to the next state. Okay? And then in this state, I can continue to see either a letter or a digit. Okay? So I can have this label which will say I can have a letter or I can see a digit. And then I can go to a final state by seeing other. Let me use this label. Okay? And what this says is that anything else which is not a letter or digit will take me to this state which will say final state. And in this final state, now I want to do something more, because I'm talking of implementation now. What are the things I'm doing in this final state? I want to now return a token and attribute. Okay? So what is the token here I'm going to return? It's an identifier, right? So I'll say that my token is ID, and what is the attribute here? Attribute could be either lexeme or an entry to the symbol table. Okay? So if this lexeme has been identified, okay, then I'm going to put this information in the symbol table, or if it was already in the symbol table, then I just need to have a pointer, but it could be pointer to symbol table corresponding to this lexeme. But then I need to do something more. And what is that something more? So I have identified, I have returned this pair, but what else do I do?
We have added one extra character. Yes.
So we have consumed one extra character. Okay, I must specify somewhere that this extra character must be returned back into the input stream. So I just put a notation here. So you can see that what I am talking about is now implementation notation. Therefore, I did not say that this is finite state machine and so on, because it is capturing all the implementation details here. Okay? So here I say that this will remind you of saying that the last character which you have consumed here must be returned back to the input stream. So this becomes your specification for implementation of an IDP file. Okay? If I try to do, let's say, for relational operation, okay? Now what will happen in relational operation? So I will some start state, okay? So let's look at for the just first two. So if I just say my reloc is less than or less than equal to, let me start with just these two, right? So in this state, what can I see? So it doesn't matter whether I'm trying to match this token or this token, I will always see less than, okay? And that will take me to a new state, okay? And in this new state, either I can see an equal or I can see something else, right? Now if I see equal, okay, do I need to look at more? Now suppose I don't have anything more in my specification, okay? Then by just longest match, I'm saying that this is what I match and therefore I can reach a final state, and then I can say that return now a reloc and let's say less than equal to, okay? But I don't have to return anything back to the stream because I am not consuming any extra symbol. But if I reach this as a final state, then I am saying that I have matched reloc, I have less than, and then I must return at least one error to the input stream. So this becomes my implementation. And then if I just enrich the whole thing, okay, if I say that I can see, say, let's say this also, okay, then what will happen? So in this state, okay, I could have had other label which would have said greater than sign here, and then as soon as I say greater than sign, definition of this other changes. So this other is all symbols which are not, so all symbols minus symbols on all other labels. Okay? So this definition of other, if I did not have this edge, this was sigma minus equal, but as soon as I add this edge, this says this is sigma minus equal and greater than. Okay? And then this will immediately say that what I have seen here, so this is not equal to, so now I'll say that I am saying that this is reloc and not equal. And then I can keep on adding more and more edges to this, and that will give me the full specification. Okay? So once we have this, okay, I can, once you have understood this part, I can take you to transition diagram. So for relocs, okay, this can be one part of the transition diagram, which says greater than equal, and this will just say that my token is reloc, lexeme is greater than equal to, or I can also say that this token is, or lexeme could be this, and many times what you will find is that it may have additional specification like saying this is greater than, okay, but as soon as I say this is greater than equal, okay, that is sufficient to say, and other will take me to this specification, but in this case I will also have to return something which is in the input C. Okay, so let me just finish this transition diagram and then we can break, okay, and for the second part, if I am now trying to capture everything, if I say this is less than, then immediately I know that I have reached a final state, and because whenever I consume other, I must return it to the input stream, and when I say this is less than equal, okay, then it is saying that I am reaching now this final state, but I am not returning anything, but if I say greater than I am reaching another final state, and again I am not returning anything, okay, and if I merge, if I take all the relational operations, okay, then I, in this state, in the start state, I can not only see less than, but I can also see greater than, which really is this transition diagram, so it will get captured here, okay, and in the start state, I can also see equal, which is here, sorry, we just went too fast, yeah, so if I see equal, then immediately I know that I am reaching this particular state, and I am just matching equal, so you can see that this becomes now your implementation specification for relational operations. Okay. So let's break. break here today, and we'll meet in the afternoon at 4:30. Okay?